Gary, do you think there's any chance you'll be doing business in China?
Yeah, as a matter of fact, if you look on our platform today, we have Chinese workers that are working today. And one of the challenges in China is we were talking about the jobs being in the metropolitan areas, but not in rural. Right. And how do you know, people are leaving the provinces after they're educated and going to Beijing because that's where the jobs are. Well, what about not leaving the province? What about working from the province, commuting to Beijing via the internet? And so I do think there's going to, you're going to see a lot of in-country to in-country. We're doing it here in the U.S. I mean, rural America is working for metropolitan America via platforms like oDesk.
So what's it like dealing with the Chinese government and an internet-based business?
So I'd say we're early here. And, you know, if you ask how are we building our business, it's based on chickens and eggs. It's sort of supply and demand. We're not proactively going saying, oh, China, there's an opportunity. Let's go. We're going based
on
the
only company in America.
Yeah, that might be doing that. But we're instead going where the market is pulling us. We see a lot of workers in Eastern Europe, and lo and behold, they start working, they tell their friends, and then the clients are coming very virally. Friends are telling friends about how great the service is, and that's how we serve the small business. Just one point about, I just want to make sure I reinforce that I think that this is great for the worker. It's about the freedom of the worker. But similarly, I think it's about boundless opportunity for the clients, for the people that need to get work done. And, you know, again, as we surveyed our clients, they said that this is strategic for their businesses. It's helped their businesses to grow. It's made their businesses more competitive. 80% said they'll continue to work this way. It wasn't just a fluke. I tried it and I'll never work this way again. So, you know, what you were saying, isn't this, would the companies not be happy about this? Instead, I think companies are thrilled now that they have this boundless opportunity to not be constrained by geography.
I think we should open up to questions. Yes, please. Why don't you tell us who you are, since we have no idea.
Thank you. I'm Sao Samgat. I work at GFDRR.
Acronyms here.
Oh, okay. The Global Facility for Disaster Reduction and Recovery. I have two questions. The first is for, I'm sorry, I didn't catch the name, Gary. Gary, right? Uh-huh. You said that you ensure that the employer pays regardless of where they are. So what if they don't pay? Where do you take them to court? Is it in their home country, or how does your legal system work?
Yeah, first I'll answer that, and then you said you had a second question. So the way oDesk works is we have this time tracking and billing system where if I'm working for you, I log in, it keeps track of all of my time. At the end of the week, we send an invoice to the client, and we say, here's the hours that your contractor worked. Now, the client can dispute the hours, but they can't dispute the quality or the speed of the work. It's like the real world in that regard. If I were on premise and I worked and you agreed to pay me $20 an hour, at the end of the week, if you didn't like the work, you still owe me $20 an hour. And so oDesk says, hey, it doesn't matter if you don't like the quality of the work or the speed. We gave you real-time visibility into it as it was happening, so you can see if they're surfing YouTube or whatever. That you can dispute, right? So then we collect from the client. If we don't collect from the client, we still pay the contractor the very next week. So the contractor gets paid because they log their time in our system. They automatically get their money. Then we go back to the client and say, hey, you agreed to pay $20. That's our problem, not anybody else's, right? And in some cases, we don't collect that money, right?
But so, do you take people to court, or is it not?
We have, but it's the breakage is so low because our clients agree to it going in. They say, this is what I agree to. Now, if they don't agree to that, if they say, I would rather pay by the piece and I'll only pay if I get what I want, that's a different story, right? We can't guarantee payment in that regard, but then the contractor can decide whether or not they want to take the risk of that job. For time-based work, we guarantee payment regardless of whether we get it.
Yeah. I have another question. Thank you. I'll throw it at the table or whoever wants to answer. What I'm hearing are stories of examples of how technology facilitates current problems and, you know, like current transfer of data and communication. But what if the technology exists but nothing to put in the vehicle, like it's an empty capsule? I'm thinking of geospatial technology, for example. You have some governments thinking of geospatial technology as very strategic, and they don't want to share any geospatial geospatial data with their markets. And on the other hand, I'm thinking of Egypt or Pakistan, for example, where geospatial data is thought of as very confidential. There is data, but it's not for public use. And on the other hand, you have private sector very hesitant about investing or getting their own versions of geospatial data. And you have this deadlock where you have the technology, but you don't know what to do with it. And you have an opportunity for creating it for job creation, but you're not able to tackle it. I don't know if that's a...
Yeah, I mean, from our perspective, the value proposition has to be there to both sides, to labor supply and labor demand. And if it's not a service that people perceive as having value, they won't utilize it. Now, thankfully, I mean, we don't have that exact scenario in the sense that we're not reliant on a single entity for the provision of the information. It's open to the labor market, individual employers. There's no prerequisite to taking part. So our challenge has always been to tweak the technology and modify it so that we're constantly providing something that's relevant to people, and they're not going to drop off, but they're going to say, you know what, posting my job by mobile phone is actually the best way to ensure that I'm getting quality workers, rather than trying to advertise by posting the a paper version publicly or trying to put it in the newspaper, which is going to be much more expensive.
Right, but Jonathan, the geospatial data is a good example. Are there big constraints on people's willingness to put information out there so it can be used?
I haven't been working specifically in that, so, you know, I'm...
Okay. Sir? Why don't you come to one of these mics at one of the tables? It'll be easier when it gets your turn.
Thank you. This is Samir Shubil. I'm the executive director, a senior advisor. We sit in these rooms to sometimes rarely to say yes or no, but for this one, it's a very enthusiastic yes. thank you, Mahmoud. Thank you, the team, for organizing something like this. It's really very original. We go beyond the usual stimulus things, interest rates, macroeconomic tools, and we talk about really things that we don't hear that much about it. So I learned a lot, and thank you so much. The only thing I will ask you, oDesk and Souktel, if you are going to do like Facebook and go public, please let me know before. I will be very interested. On a more serious note, I come from Tunisia, the country which started the, before our dear friend Mahmoud, the Egyptian, followed the language problem, the French, not only for North Africa, but for a large part of the Africa countries. I know it's our problem. We should have learned more French. But to what extent that could be addressed? Also, to what extent you are having this problem of how do people recognize you? How, I mean, if you send me an email like this, I would have thought it's a spam. After today, I know you. I would have thought it's a spam. So please also try to use our resources. There are many people in the executive board here who will be willing to push for your actions, to talk to their Minister of Labor and others to help. So if there's any way we can help, let us know, because this is really fantastic. Thank you so much.
Samir, thank you. I guess just to answer the questions briefly, I'll speak to how our service works, at least. In terms of brand ID, we typically partner with the mobile phone networks so that every SMS you receive is from a labeled entity. So they know us as Souktel, in whether it's in Tunisia, where we have one service running at the moment and another on the way, to Kenya or to Rwanda. We do a lot of promotion in partnership with mobile networks and in partnership with ministries of labor at institutions, in the media. So the brand is known, and when a message comes to your phone, whether it's in Arabic, French, or English, it will specify who it's coming from, and you'll say, okay, this is not just another, you know, win a new car thing. This is Souktel. I know that brand. This contains information that's useful to me. Language-wise, again, we're a bit different from oDesk in the sense that we're focusing on local labor markets. So the service is very much custom-tailored to each individual country. In Tunisia, it operates in French and Arabic. It does not operate in Amazigh or other similar languages, but it could. In Iraq, for example, it operates in Arabic and Kurdish. In Rwanda, it's English, French, and Kinyarwanda. So the platform, and I won't speak for oDesk, but I'm sure, you know, it's the same type of notion that it can be customized to work in any language. So on the contrary, I mean, I really, you know, don't think that English needs to be the lingua franca. I think that